Hello, welcome back aboard the USS Enterprise here in the Gulf of Tonkin on this very, very dark night for another episode of Strike Fighters II Vietnam. Today's date is May 17th, 1967, and it was during this week that the US dropped its first precision-guided munitions on Vietnam. On May 19th, 2 days from now, VA-212 will drop AGM-62 walleyes on the Hanoi Thermal Power Plant. The walleye was the US's first smart bomb and was television guided. The 19th of May also happens to be Ho Chi Minh's 77th birthday. We ourselves are actually bombing a power plant today, though we will not be using anything fancy. We'll just be using just good old freefall iron bombs. We are to strike a strategic target located in the Futo Electric Power Plant, attack and destroy the enemy power plant. Call sign will be Dallas. We'll be taking two F4 Phantoms. Takeoff time will be 21:17, that's 9:17 at night. Over the target by 21:35, back to the boat by 22:08. Looking at the loadout now, after the unfortunate loss of aircraft 100 in the previous episode, we are now flying aircraft 107, and we'll be packing a punch. Instead of our normal 500-pound bombs, I'll be taking eight 1,000-pound bombs. In addition to that, I have the normal air-to-air defense loadout of four Sidewinders and four Sparrows. And tonight I'll actually finally be switching to the AIM-9 Delta Sidewinders, which are much improved over the Bravos that we've been using. The Delta model was introduced by the Navy last year in 1966, specifically to address some of the problems that the Bravo was having, as it was such garbage. And I had remembered that wrong. I thought that the Navy had stuck with the Bravo, but it was actually the Air Force. The Air Force did not switch over to the Delta Sidewinder, and they stuck with the Bravo for a long time, and it did them no favors in their air-to-air kills. But Navy definitely using the Delta since last year, in fact, so we're going to switch over to that and start flying with those. So we should notice a marked improvement in our Sidewinder performance. Total takeoff weight for tonight is 57,400 pounds, and Dallas 2, an aircraft 113, is equipped with the same loadout. We'll be taking off from the Enterprise here at Yankee Station, circling around to head northwest up towards Waypoint 3. We'll be crossing over the coastline at Waypoint 3, just south of the city of Tan Hoa and the mouth of the Ma River. I'll have climbed to 25,000 feet already at this point, so we'll continue making our way northwest inland in preparation for dive bombing, hitting waypoint 4 at around 14 minutes. After that, we're heading north up to our target, which is located on the outskirts of the city of Phu To along the banks of the Red River. Here's a recon photo of today's target so we can know what we're looking for on the way in. Out to the west, we have the transmission line and the substation towers. These are pretty tall structures, so even in the darkness, hopefully they'll be fairly identifiable. That'll help us get our bearings. To the south, we have fuel storage and support buildings, and our main target is the primary power plant building itself, the largest building on site. Thermal power plant is just a general term, meaning that heat is used to create the electricity. This includes nuclear power, by the way. That's a type of thermal power plant. The term thermal just distinguishes the power plant from, say, hydroelectric, you know, using water to create electricity, or solar, which was not a technology at the time, but is now. Most power plants in Vietnam at the time were either coal or oil fired, and in this case, because of the large fuel storage buildings all over the place, I'm going to assume this is an oil plant. So inside that power plant building is going to be a series of large boilers, all the steam piping, condensers, and the turbines. In fact, almost all of the same equipment that we would find in our own engine rooms on board our ships out at Yankee Station, because it's the same process, essentially, just scaled up. After we hit our target, we're egressing out to the northeast, passing north of the city of Thai Win. In fact, let's move this waypoint in just a little bit to save us some distance. So we'll actually go right over the top of Thai Win, just north of Kep Air Base, before heading to the southeast, back out into the Gulf of Tonkin, just north of Haiphong. And then once we're safely out to sea, it's back to the south to land back at Yankee Station. I'm in Dallas 1 with 59 combat missions, 24 air-to-air kills. My wingman today will be Ensign Ray Voden in Dallas 2. We've taken him before. He's got 11 combat missions, 3 air-to-air kills. And his stats are looking pretty good today. He's 94 condition, 99 morale. So he's looking good for tonight's mission. And that's it. That's the briefing for tonight. We'll see you upstairs on the flight deck as we get ready to go. Dallas flight is ready to go. Flight controls look good. Navigation lights are on. As I salute down to the catapult officer, sit back and wait for launch. Dallas 1 is airborne. Gear is up. Flaps are up. It's nighttime, so we're making a Case 3 departure away from the ship, which means we just fly straight out away from the ship and begin our climb up to cruise altitude, keeping us away from the very dark waters underneath us. And speaking of dark, as we get the radar online and throw the ECM on and get our weapons and nav situated, you'll notice that it's very, very dark. I recently upgraded to the realSKY 1.2 mod. We've actually been using it for the last couple of episodes, but it's been daytime, so it's harder to notice. One of the improvements of the mod is that at nighttime, they've made it really pitch black, which is very realistic and is really fun to play. It's not so good for recording it. So I definitely recommend watching this one in a low light situation, because this is going to be really dark, which I'm actually not opposed to artistically. I like the idea of making a video that's super, super dark. You really get the feeling of the isolation of flying at night, just that very soft glow of the instrument panel. Having the added challenge of navigating, you can't even see when you're over the water versus land. I really like that. I really like the effect of that. So I don't have a problem making you, the viewer, suck it up and have to watch a dark video if it makes you feel more immersed. That I like. What I don't like is YouTube's shitty encoding and auto enhancement, which they now throw onto every video. It used to be that the auto enhancement was an option that you could select, and then it would try to adjust the contrast and brightness to make it look good. Now we don't have that option anymore. YouTube automatically does it as soon as you upload. And that's fine if you're uploading video from, say, your cell phone or from a webcam and you're just throwing stuff up. Whatever, that's great. But if you're actually trying to make a video look a certain way, the auto enhancement destroys that. And I've actually had that happen a couple of times. Super frustrating. So not only does YouTube try to brighten up the dark spots, which I'm trying to intentionally leave, but the MP4 encoding also makes it look like it's an 8-bit video game. Now, having said that, there is one workaround that I'm going to try with this video, and obviously at this time of recording, I don't know if it's going to work, but we're definitely going to give it a go, and that's to trick YouTube into thinking that it's a 4K video. So I'm recording this in 1920 by 1080. Just on my monitor, but when I export it, I'm going to knock it up to 4K, which is 3840 by 2160. And I have done a test of this, and it looked really, really great. So this is probably going to be an hour-long video. Hopefully the size of the file is not going to restrict me. What I'm really, really hoping for is going to be a nice, crystal clear, up to 4K resolution video that is going to remain as dark as I want it to. So, anyways, that's the whole thing. That's my airing of grievances regarding uploading videos to YouTube. Sometimes I put a lot of work into something only to have it ruined or look like garbage just from the uploading and encoding process. Even if I export it as an MP4 on the computer, it still looks great, but that extra step of uploading it to YouTube and then they compress it further, it really starts to make it look not as good as I wish it would. And if you're watching this on a phone, you know, then it's not so noticeable, but if you bring it up on the big screen, I don't want to be embarrassed by the quality of the visuals. So, now one trick I was using before to try to fool YouTube and the auto enhance was to click the brightness up a few points during the nighttime episodes. And now this mod actually makes the nighttime so dark that I really can't even do that anymore, because as soon as I start to mess with the gamma and the contrast and the brightness, you kind of get some other weird video effects going. So really, that doesn't even have the benefit that it used to, so I may just forego that completely. We'll see in the editing process if I bump it up a little bit or not. But it's still going to be really, really dark. And again, I'm okay with it being really, really dark. I'm okay with not being able to see anything. What I don't want is the dark areas to be all pixelated and gross looking. So hopefully, my fingers are crossed here. Hopefully, we're going to be able to work around that. Tonight, I'd like to talk about the root packs of Vietnam. You'll hear these things mentioned in any book or discussion about the air war in Vietnam, but I haven't brought them up before because they don't apply here in the game. The game doesn't restrict missions or targets based on which service you fly for, and in real life, that's exactly what the root packs did. The system is actually very easy to understand though, so let's discuss how and why they came into use. The aerial bombing of Vietnam started in August of 1964, just after the Gulf of Tonkin incident, and was handled exclusively by US Navy carriers. As the bombing intensified and Air Force aircraft began arriving in country, planning the missions and assigning targets became an administrative nightmare. It was difficult to conduct joint operations, especially because the Air Force only ran one strike per day, while the Navy usually conducted two or more. And finally, to cap it all off, only a small list of targets was approved by the White House, so the Air Force and Navy found themselves competing for both resources and targets. Just after 1 year of bombing, in September of 1965, strikes were halted to give North Vietnam a chance to come to the peace table. During this lull, Air Force and Navy officials worked out and implemented the Route Package system. Route packages were areas of air operations, officially assigning each branch its own areas of responsibility. Route Pack 1 was the area just north of the demilitarized zone. From there, the areas increased in number, with Pack 6 including both Hanoi and Haiphong. As it happened, Route Pack 1 had the least AA and very rarely any SAMs or fighters, so missions there were considered the easiest, while Route Pack 6, where AAA, SAMs, and MiGs were heavily concentrated, became synonymous with the most dangerous missions. Air Force F-105 squadrons would send rookie pilots on several Route Pack 1 missions to cut their teeth before they were even allowed to go downtown up in Route Pack 6. Pack 6 was further divided into two halves, A and B. The Air Force, coming in from the south and the west, took responsibility for Route Packs 1, 5, and 6A, the Hanoi area. The Navy, coming in from the sea, covered Route Packs 2, 3, 4, and 6B, the Haiphong area. The system worked quite well. The main drawbacks were that if bad weather obscured a target in Pack 5 or 6, Air Force aircraft had to divert all the way down to Pack 1, bypassing many lucrative targets in the Navy areas. It also meant that the Air Force aircraft had a much longer distance to fly, which necessitated the use of airborne tankers for both the ride in and out of Vietnam. These long missions needed massive coordination, and organizing a huge fleet of refueling aircraft was why the Air Force only committed to one strike a day. South Vietnam was also divided into four areas, though these were areas of responsibility for ground troops, not aircraft, and they were called military regions. Military Region 1 included the northern section of the country, beginning at the DMZ. Military Region 2 covered the Central Highlands. MR3, the area between the Central Highlands and Saigon, including the capital city itself. And finally, MR4 covered the Mekong Delta, southwest of Saigon, a perpetual hotbed of Viet Cong infiltration for the entire war. Air Force, Navy, and Marine aircraft shared responsibility in the south, and all flew equally in the area. It also seems that Route Pack 6 often did have some crossover or joint operations, as Navy aircraft routinely flew missions into Hanoi proper. The Route Pack and Military Region system would remain in place and in use throughout the entire war, until the US's departure in 1972. Alright, we're coming up on the coast now, so it's about time to turn off our navigation lights. There we go, they're off. As we're nearly on top of waypoint 3, which is going to indicate that we're over land, which I can barely see down there. You may not be able to see it at all, but We're just about to enter North Vietnam. 1 mile away from the waypoint. Oh, and it switched over. Okay, waypoint 3 has been reached. We're on to waypoint 4, which is 47 miles out now. Explosion down to the right. Somebody just took out some sort of, I'm assuming, air defense gun. Yeah, you can see some more flashes down there from flak firing, I think. So we probably have an Iron Hand flight in the area, taking out AAA guns underneath us right now. Oop, and there's our first radar spike of the night. More explosions out there. That looks like flak guns firing, actually. There's Dallas 2, still on my wing. He's extinguished his nav lights as well, which is good. We don't need to be giving the gunners a visual target, along with hitting us with the radar. Wow, there's a bunch of shit right underneath us, including a P-35 early warning radar. Oh! I hit the burners to speed us out of the area, and we immediately picked up flak. There's more, possibly from those guns down to the right. That puff was pretty close. Bandits still more than 50 miles out. It's not really a factor just yet. Escorts are engaging in air combat. Sparrows and Sidewinders being launched somewhere out to the north, taking care of those MiGs. More Sparrows. And North Vietnam responding in kind with surface-to-air missiles. One MiG is down. And we're clear of the radar, so no SAMs down by us. That must have just been directing the radar-guided AAA. Yeah, and we're pretty far out now from whatever was going on. A couple of guns still down there, though, letting us know that they know we're up here. More Sparrows away at MiGs. So we're looking around, nothing to see down here. Just the glow of the instrument panel, and then the occasional crazy illumination from flak going off nearby. When you do have a light source, it really frames it in the darkness, so explosions on the ground or the flak going off, when it lights up the cockpit, it's much more noticeable at night. And the tracers look beautiful when they're arcing through the sky. Not so beautiful looking when they slam into you, I guess, but from afar, you know, it's like a 4th of July fireworks display. Okay, we're at 25,000 feet still, just over 350 knots. We're 8 miles away from our initial point. Red Crown informing us that those MiGs are now within 25 miles of us. Sam's going crazy up to the north, and escorts are launching lots of missiles. So I think we're pretty much out of harm's way from those. Yeah, from those MiGs. I think more are getting shot down. We have to be nearly on top of that waypoint now. Yes, we are. There we go. Waypoint 4 is reached. Heading to waypoint 5, turning in towards our target. So, at this point, we want to arm our 1,000-pound bombs. Set up our gun sight. course, here in the game, that happens automatically. As we're turning to target, Red Crown reports a bandit very nearby, within just a few miles, although down below us. Oop. Pulling up to maintain my altitude through the turn. We dipped a little bit low. Rolling out on course 21 miles out from the target now. Going full power on the afterburners, getting some speed up to separate us from wherever these enemy aircraft are in our vicinity. We just hit the internal fuel, so it's going to be time to ditch this drop tank. Over on my left on the missile status panel, you can see the green TKs illuminated. That's telling me that the drop tank is still attached. When I jettison it, we're going to watch that green light, watch it go out. So that's actually a visual indication of whether or not I still have the tanks aboard. Let's ditch the tank. The green light goes out. And let's tell the wingman to do the same. Dallas 2 drop tanks. I'm keeping the J-79s at full power, speeding away from that enemy MiG. Hopefully, escorts will take care of them. Oh yeah, 3 o'clock and he's 7 miles out, down to 5,000 feet. So either he's engaged in combat, or he's been shot down, and he's going down. Okay, way down there, barely visible in the darkness, is the city of Viet Tri, which is to the northwest of Hanoi. We can see the Red River, barely. Hanoi is out to our 3 o'clock at this point, and we're 8 miles out from the target. So coming off the afterburners, we'll stay up at full military power. Picking up another radar spike. This might be an actual fan song SAM guiding radar. Not just AAA anymore, because we're pretty far north. But we're just about 4 miles out, so it's about time to tell Dallas 2 to attack my target. And we're following suit, nosing over as well. There's 30 degrees down. There's 60 degrees down. Looking now for the target in the darkness, can barely see it. Sort of being illuminated by ground fire. I think it's right there in front of us. And I've got a SAM incoming! Not sure where from, but we're about 6,000 feet. Bombs away as we're pulling out. Dodging flak, tracers, and SAMs from somewhere. There's our bomb impact. Complete miss. Looks like it's outside of the entire power plant. God damn. Wow. That must be an Iron Hand flight suppressing air defenses around the target for us. There we go, there's a second one. Alright, so I missed the target completely, but I'm pretty sure the Dallas 2 never dropped his bombs. So, let's circle back around. I'm going to send him back in on a second run. Let me just double check to make sure that I'm still locked onto the primary target, which I am. Dallas 2, attack my target once again. Okay, and he's in hot immediately as we continue circling around. I haven't seen any missiles, but this fan song has a solid lock on me still. But that's okay. That means that if it's locked onto me, it's not locked onto Dallas 2, so that's one less radar that he needs to worry about. That's the power plant out off the left wing. We're just circling above it right now. Voden is pulling out. Yes! Look at that. Beautiful. Right through the center of the site. And no bandits in the area. Excellent job, Ensign Voden. Let's get the flight back together. Get the hell out of here and egress out to the north. A new SAM launch. Shit. Alright, let's just continue around. Try to spot it. I can't see it. Dive for the ground a little bit, and then we'll pull back up, try to outmaneuver it. Wow, there it was! Continuing this full power dive down towards the ground, which I cannot even see. I'm just staring at my altimeter. Just about 6,000 feet. Let's level out here. Okay, I see some peaks out in the distance, so we're not close to any mountains. I think this is actually Thud Ridge out in front of us here. We got F4s on the radar out ahead of us. Lots of returns, but I think they're all friendly. Red Crown did just tell us that we have no bandits in the area, so these must all be American aircraft on their way out of the target area. Light flak out at the 11 o'clock again. Looks like they're tracking somebody. There's an American plane. No idea what it is. I just saw the light reflecting off the wings. So let's pull up and away from that. Let's get back up to 25,000 feet as we're coming over Tai Win here. In just a few moments, on our way back out towards the ocean. 20 miles out to the next waypoint, in fact. Picking up a new radar. It's possible that's the AAA radar that was just tracking that other American. Hopefully that's the case, so we don't have to dodge more missiles. There's Dallas 2 behind us, climbing to stay with us, getting back in formation. Picking up a tad of flak nearby. Oh wow, did you see that? That was a SAM launch, a missile flare from down there next to the river. And we're clear of the radar for the moment. Alright, coming up on 25,000 feet now, leveling out. There we go. We'll come back down. Get right on altitude, and we'll hit the wing leveler. We have 8,300 pounds of fuel still left on board in the internal tanks, which is still pretty decent. We can run the afterburners for a little bit more with that amount of fuel and still make it home okay, so not worried there. I am worried that there continues to be massive amounts of SAM launches. Ooh, Dallas is actually way far back there. Oh, he's actually right over that SAM site, too, that I saw. We could see it on the map there. It was sort of a blob of red. But that was in the position. I couldn't even actually read it, but that was the position that that launch came from. So he's right over the SAM site. Hopefully, they're not going to target him. There's waypoint 6. We're 50 miles away from waypoint 7, so we'll make the turn, and we're on our way out of the country now. Just a few more miles and we'll be feet wet back over the ocean. And if we can just make it these last few miles without getting shot down, we're going to be home free. Other flights reporting that they're hitting waypoint 7, so most flights are getting out of the country or are out of the country at this point. There's a few left behind, including us, so we just got to get our tails out of here. Denver hitting waypoint 7. Yeah, we're pretty far over land still. But there's not a whole lot out here. There is a Fansong B radar, so an SA-2 Bravo. Oh, what is Ensign Voden doing? Return to formation, please. He's not doing it. Do we have any... Nope, no bandits in the area, so we are clear. He's kind of wandering away. Yeah, here, let's just tell him to cover my six, and hopefully that'll get him to return to formation. Oh yeah. That sort of worked. I want him to close up. I want his ECM protection for both of us. Just in time to be hit by another radar. That's Haiphong out to the right, far in the distance. But yeah, we have this Fansong B that's coming up pretty close to the right, so... hopefully maybe they fired all their missiles and they're in the process of reloading. And they won't take any shots at us, but I guess we'll see. So that SAM site right down there, somewhere to the right, just under the nose there, I think. Yeah, just right down there. Shit, and I've got a SAM incoming right at me from that site, I'll bet. There it is! Full power, do you see it coming? It's tracking on me. And a near miss right behind the tail, speeding off into the night. We were able to dodge it with speed alone that time. And, once again, the ALQ-51, preventing its proximity fusing from exploding. And by the way, I looked up the SA-2s in the files. They do have a proximity fuse modeled here in the game. So, I think that ECM of ours is actually benefiting us greatly by preventing them from exploding nearby. Looking for more missiles now from that same site, since they still have a lock on us, but I don't see any additional flares coming up. As long as a Fansong has a lock on a target, it can direct up to 3 missiles at a time up to that one target. So, and they frequently did. That was standard practice in Vietnam to fire 2 or 3 missiles at a target, especially as US ECM started making it harder to hit the American aircraft. They started shotgunning more missiles into the sky. Now we're picking up flak as well. Here's Dallas 2 down low again. Rejoin, please. As he's flying probably directly over that SAM site. I don't need him getting shot down too. Okay, we lost the radar lock. As we're back in the cockpit, we can hear that the raw equipment is silent. As we're 8 miles out from this waypoint. Should be well out over the ocean now. Hard to tell just by looking down. Voden has a SAM coming up at him. Dallas 2, break. That's the worst break I've ever seen. Well, I called this, didn't I? SA-2 site launching at Dallas 2. Looks like it's coming in behind him. I see that flare at his 6 o'clock, getting closer. Telling him to break again. There we go, it's going wide. Passing harmlessly well beneath him and out to sea. Okay, for real, Voden, rejoin. Pulling back to cruise power as we swing around on course. I think we are well and clear of Vietnam now. Just that one last scare on Dallas 2 because he's lagging behind. But Dallas 1 should be completely clear of the action at this point. I think we're safe. Rolling out on course, we're 76 miles away from Yankee Station. As we snap on the wing leveler and settle back in for a nice, quiet, dark ride back home. There we can see the balance of American aircraft are back out over the ocean heading in. Looks like Gopher and Olds flights are still out over the Haiphong area and the Nam Dinh area. So, I don't know if they're suppressing AAA or what's going on, but hopefully they'll be hightailing it out of there soon as well. But if they are Iron Hand, that's the job. You're first in, last out. But they're definitely the last out at this point, so hopefully they get a move on. Oh, I would like to make a small correction. in the last episode, in the heat of combat, I had a brain fart. I said that because I saw an afterburner on a J5 that it was a J5A, which is not correct. A J5, the base model J5, that is the equivalent of a MiG-17F, which is the afterburner-equipped MiG-17. The J5A is actually the radar-equipped MiG-17PF, so that one is much more advanced and a lot less likely to be seen here. So I just wanted to correct that from last time. I thought that we were chasing a J5A, but it was not. It was just a regular J5, and that's the difference. The J5 is a MiG-17F, J5A, MiG-17PF. But for night intercepts, a J5A is exactly what they should be using. That's probably what we would really see tonight. Not these day fighters, so not the regular MiG-17s or even the MiG-17Fs. It would be very difficult for the day fighter versions of the MiGs to find anything out here in this inky blackness and shoot it down. But the radar-equipped MiG-17PFs or the J5As, that's exactly what they were designed to do. So that's what we would see up here tonight. Thirty miles out from the final waypoint, this is where I want to begin my descent down to 10,000 feet as I get set up for my Case 3 arrival and ILS landing back on the Enterprise. I'm really looking forward to this. This is going to be really cool. This is going to be 100% on instruments approach. There's no way I can possibly cheat because it's just so goddamn dark out. There is no way to see anything accidentally. I'm legit not going to be able to see the ship. So if you're not familiar with the Case 3 arrival, we'll go through it again. We'll do a little landing brief on that. We're going to be on radar control to 10 miles astern of the ship at 5,000 feet. Now, I'm amending that a little bit because we have to reach the final waypoint so that the nav system locks into the ship itself. So, I'm going to continue this descent down to 10,000, and then we'll overfly the ship and we'll make a big left marshalling stack turn and then head back astern. The nav system will be set up on the ship at that point, and so all of our needles will be functioning properly. We'll descend down to 5,000 feet as we swing back around, and then we'll hit that 10-point mark astern of the ship. So that's going to be our initial point that we're going to be heading towards. 10 miles astern, 5,000 feet. Less than 250 knots. When we hit that 10-mile mark, that's when we switch to landing configuration, so we'll pull the power back, gear will drop down, full flaps, when we'll reach 160 knots as an approach speed, and at that point, we just start following the glide slope down in towards the ship. I'm going to be maintaining around 160 knots as an approach speed on the way in. I don't really want to drop below 150. I don't want this Phantom to stall out from underneath me and drop into the ocean. That would not be good. But I also don't want to be too fast, so somewhere in the 160 plus or minus 10 range, I think. And we're going to just ride the beams in all the way down till about 1 mile away from the ship. And that's when maybe we'll start looking up out of the cockpit and start looking to see if we can catch the ship visually. We may not see it until about half a mile, maybe even a quarter mile. Probably not that far, because we're not in bad weather. So somewhere between a mile and half a mile out, we should finally see the ship, and then we'll switch over visually, and then we'll land that last half mile by visually looking at the ship. So that's going to be the plan. I'm always excited when I get to showcase my instrument flying skills, because I have found watching videos of guys who are otherwise really good combat pilots getting into the clouds and then have openly admitted that they have no experience flying on instruments. It surprised me at first, but then I thought about it, and I guess that sort of makes sense. If you're just flying combat flight sims, which usually all take place during the day and in partly cloudy weather, for the most part, I mean, a lot of times, you know, And there's no need for precision instrument work because you're usually VFR. So I'm excited to showcase some instrument approaches here in this game. It's going to be pitch black out, so mostly my head's going to be in the cockpit here looking at the instrument panel. And even looking outside, even if I do happen to glance out, I mean, you literally can't see anything. I mean, that's the water down there. Supposedly, there's ships down there. Certainly can't see them here, so this is legit going to be following the needles, which will be fun. We're about 2 miles away from our final selectable waypoint, waypoint 8. Once we hit that, there'll be two more to go, and then the nav system will be dialed in on the ship itself, which is what I'm specifically looking for. There's waypoint 8, we've reached that, rolling over to waypoint 9. So now we're just maintaining 10,000 feet. There's Dallas 2, Ensign Voden off my left wing. He has not separated automatically, which he should have done right there at that waypoint. Oh, and I'm dipping a little low, so back up to cruise power, we'll pull back up through the turn as we come around. At some point, maybe during the marshalling stack, I'll just have to tell Voden manually to return to base to make sure he separates. Yep, still with me. And back up to 10,000 feet. Wing leveler is on. Good to go. Bring the radar down just for... Oh, that's the second time that's happened. I'm in a flight with only two aircraft, and I get a call from three for bingo fuel. Very strange. There is no three. It may be two. I wonder if it's just glitched, and it's actually two is telling me that he's bingo fuel. Okay, so down there to the left, 11 o'clock, very low. That's Ford flight making its way on final approach into the Enterprise. You can just see the nav lights popping into existence down there to the left. Also an indicator that that's where the ship is, which we definitely could not see at all. And there's the final waypoint. We're getting the call the ball message, which, you know, doesn't mean anything in this case, because we're definitely not actually calling the ball here. But that's just telling me that's the final waypoint. Nav system is now locked into the Enterprise. The first arrow here is telling me the course of the ship. Right there, that's the course of the Enterprise, and the second arrow off to the left is actually telling us where the ship is itself, and I can just barely see it for a moment down there underneath us, so we'll kind of level out where, not really parallel, but close enough. But there it's out to the 9 o'clock, we're just passing by the ship, so we're going to begin a nice lazy turn to the left for the marshalling stack. We're going to turn 180 degrees. Which in this case will be, what is that, 220? Slightly more than 220, like 221 or 222 degrees. And maintain 10,000 feet. I say as we're dropping down to 9,500. But I want to maintain 10,000 until we're on the downwind leg of this marshalling stack. And then we'll drop down to 5. We're just 5.5 miles out from the ship, almost touching 6, which is good. Don't want to be too much further than that. Usually 5 miles is recommended, but we went into the turn kind of fast. We're about 425 knots. Probably should have been closer to like 350, but that's okay. We're just in a nice tight bank. We'll come around. Nearly there. And then we'll begin descending, and then we're going to watch that DME, and I'm going to go out to 12 miles before turning back in so that we hit 10 miles, and we're situated nice and steady. And rolling out. There we go. So we are 180 degrees opposite of the ship's course, and it's just out to my 9 o'clock. You can see that other arrow moving. No idea where it is. Cannot see it. And now that we're past the 9 o'clock position, pulling the throttle to idle, and then we begin our descent down to 5,000 feet. Dallas 2, return to base. Alright, Voden is out of here. He's on his own. He's going to set up for his landing and come in on his own. We're going to continue down, like I said, to about 12 miles out. Lots of aircraft coming back in, so we have to make this sort of snappy. Can't take too much time. The whole purpose of the Case 3 arrival and departure is because it's IFR conditions, whether it's bad weather or it's nighttime, you're spacing out the aircraft to arrive and depart from the ship. So there's no VFR, there's no brake. You're not having aircraft maneuver low to the ground or in large numbers, you know, groups. Instead, radio controllers would be directing the aircraft and spacing them out so that it's much more safe to come aboard at night. You're not all bunched up in the sky where you possibly would not be able to see other aircraft. 15 miles out now, just under 6,000 feet. I'm going to make my turn so that we swing back around. We're going to get onto course for final and then get the airplane ready to land. As we're just reaching 5,000 feet, I'm keeping the power back and just pulling the nose up so we bleed some of this excess speed. We're just at 300 knots now. I need 250 to drop the gear, and then 220 knots to drop the flaps. ...16 miles from the ship. Like I said, I want to be leveled out and ready to drop into that landing configuration as soon as we hit 10 miles. And the ship is down there somewhere. Hook is down and locked. We're steady at 230 knots, 5,000 feet, and we're just looking to start centering those needles now. Glide slope is still above us, and center line needle is out to the right, so we're compensating by flying a little bit further to the right to let that recenter on us. Making some minute power changes here. I've got a return out ahead of us. Two returns, actually, on the radar. About 15 miles out. Okay, that's Austin flight passing from left to right, so that should not be a factor. We should clear them with no problem. Okay, we're just touching the glide slope now as we are coming down to 10 miles, right where we want to be. So we're intercepting the glide slope right where we need to, at 10 miles. And that also means it's time to drop the gear. Landing light coming on as we configure the aircraft in landing configuration. Flaps are full, gear is down. Making my left turn towards the center line. And we're a little above glide slope now, so I'm going to let the plane descend at 2,000 feet per minute. The glide slope angle is 1,000 feet per minute, so we're just doing twice that, so we should gradually sink beneath it And then as we re-intercept the glide slope, I'll just add a bit of power to come back up to 1,000. We should be right on target, and then ride it in from there. Speed's down to 170. With a lot going on here. Watching altitude, watching airspeed, watching the two needles, both centerline, which is now coming in to center, so we have to turn back towards the ship. And also watching the glide slope, which we are getting closer and closer to. We're going to intercept here in just a moment. Rolling out on the ship's course. Center line is slightly to our left, which is fine because it's going to be moving to our right because of the movement of the ship. So I'm going to take that into account. We're 5 miles out from the flight deck. Pitch black out. I have zero visual contact on anything. But there's our glide slope. We're now slightly below. So bring the nose up, bring the power up. We'll re-intercept it and let it drop back down to 1,000 feet per minute. There we go. So 1,000. So we are. We should be directly riding the glide slope now. Center line slightly to our left. We're 4 miles out, 165 knots. Less than 2,000 feet. We're at 1,900 feet. Plenty of fuel. Over 5,200 pounds if we need to go around. And we look great. We are situated. We are right in the slot here. I'm very pleased about this. Just minute corrections. Now we're a little left. We'll just bring it back to the right. Still just above 160 knots. 2.5 miles to go. Feet. Confirmed by the radar altimeter as well, checking both altimeters against each other, 160, 159 knots actually. 1.5 miles. Center line needle is a little bit to the right. We could use a touch of power to get back up to 160. 1 mile to go. For the first time in this approach, I'm going to look outside the cockpit, try to get a visual on the ship. There we go, I can barely see it, but I do have it. So now we're on visual approach, one last look. Speed's getting up a little bit, but that's okay. Alright, I can see the landing area. Here we go, on visual approach now for the final few hundred feet. Touchdown, right on the center line, and it's a good capture. Lights off, radar off, hook is up, flaps are up, folding the wings. And taxiing clear of the landing zone, ready for the next aircraft to arrive behind us. So, very happy with that approach and landing. That went great. Very pleased. The mission in general went well, I think. So let's shut down this aircraft here. There we go. You can see the RPM spooling down. So we're going to secure this F4, open the canopy, and we'll see you back in the ready room to debrief this mission. Alright, great work tonight. Our objective was to strike a strategic target located in the Futo Electric Power Plant. Flight time was 53 minutes and 37 seconds. Primary target was destroyed for a success, score of 250. That score, of course, low because I didn't actually hit the primary target. The wingman did, but we got it done. In fact, here's the weapon stats. We both dropped 8 1,000-pound bombs. It actually says that I hit 5 targets, but didn't actually kill anything, whereas Voden got 8 hits and 5 kills. So, yeah, I must have done a little bit of damage to something, but not enough to blow it up. But Voden definitely, I mean, we saw his bombs just go right through the facility, so excellent job on his part. So here's the log. At 9:35, an SA-2B guideline launched at me. That's when I was pushing over into the dive on the target. That's the second time that's happened, by the way. And just 7 seconds later, I released all 8 of my 1,000-pound bombs. And apparently hit a warehouse with 1,000-pounders. Those were the 5 hits on one or several warehouses. But again, not enough to actually drop them. At 9:37, Voden swung around. He dropped his bombs, and he destroyed a warehouse, a fuel tank, several fuel tanks, and the power plant building itself, which is exactly what we needed to get. Oh, we also destroyed a POL tank. That's petroleum, oils, and lubricants. So basically one of the fuel storage tanks on site. He took that out as well. And then after that, we were basically inundated with AAA for a while. And then down here at the bottom, 9:44, that SA-2 just outside of Haiphong fired at me. And 2 minutes later, fired a second SA-2 at Voden as we were egressing out of the country. And that was it. And then we made our way back to the Enterprise, where we landed very safely. So really, that was only 2 missiles at each of us tonight. So a big difference from last mission, where we had about 40 billion missiles launched at us. And then a quick look at the roster. This was my 60th mission. 24 air-to-air kills, 118 air-to-ground. And no change with anybody else except for Ray Voden now having 12 combat missions. And there we go. That was today's mission out into deep into Route Pack 6 up into North Vietnam to destroy a power plant. Just 2 days prior to the Hanoi power plant historically being attacked and destroyed. Finally put out of commission. I hope you enjoyed this one. I know it was very dark, but hopefully you were okay with that. Hopefully YouTube hasn't made it look like garbage and it was actually enjoyable to just be alone with your thoughts in the night with just the stars looking down on you. It's a very unique experience to fly at night in the dark. And so wanted to recreate that a little bit here. Hopefully it, you know, came out all right. Next mission will probably be back during the day. So even if you hated this episode, you'll be able to see again with no problem in the next one. So join me then. Have a great rest of your day. We'll see you next time.